from Buffalo Wild Wings in Fargo, welcome to Benchwarmers. Today's featured guests are Midco Sports Network analyst Steve Hallstrom, assistant football coach at North Dakota State Tyler Roehl, play-by-play voice for NDSU football Brian Shawn, and our host, Midco Sports Network's Tom Nieman.
Welcome to Buffalo Wild Wings in Fargo, where even in July, Bison football, always a hot topic. We'll get to that with our esteemed panel here. But first, World Cup, gentlemen, it's done. Are you bummed about this? 2 weeks ago on this show, I predicted that Germany would win the World Cup. Thank you very much. And then I was told that it wasn't that big a deal because they were one of the favorites. But I kind of had to force myself to get into it. And then when I did, I enjoyed it. Was it the same for you guys in the World Cup experience?
I didn't watch a whole bunch. You know, I was gone, but I, you know, followed USA, obviously. All right. But after that, I didn't follow too much at all.
I got into it a little bit. I think whenever USA plays anybody in anything, I'm interested. And then when Jurgen Klinsmann came out before the first game and said, we basically have no chance to win it, I said, okay, I can pay attention to this because I want to see if his players might beat the tar out of him at halftime or something in the first game. But maybe you knew what he was doing. They played well.
Once the U.S. was done, did you hang in there?
No, I didn't. The thing is, what I found interesting was watching the reaction of everybody else on social media and throughout the rest of the country react to the World Cup. I found that to be more interesting than the World Cup itself. I just find that fascinating how people jump on it and then jump off of it right away when it's done.
Do you get offended when they call it football?
A little bit. Yeah, there is a little bit of physicality, but not nearly what American football is. Not even close.
Maybe that's why I don't like it, is the fact every time a guy goes down, you got to bring a stretcher out to take him out. I just think that's ridiculous. I can't get over that. A stretcher every time a guy goes down, and then 5 minutes later, he miraculously runs out of the tunnel and he's fine. Oh, those guys, I tell you.
That kind of made it fun to watch.
It's like a soap opera. It's terrible.
All right, moving on. The biggest story in this country, at least in the last week, LeBron James coming home to Cleveland. Are you guys moved by this, or what was your reaction to LeBron coming back?
Well, he did it right this time. And I thought more was said last time of the way he did it. I didn't think it was that big of a deal, other than the fact he didn't really notify his current team what he was doing first. I thought that was a little cheap. I thought he really showed a good example of how you should do it. It was pretty classy as he left Miami. And he came back home for the right reasons. You could say you chase money. You can always get more money staying where you're at. For him, I think he's the kind of guy who definitely wants to be popular and liked. I think that's part of what we've seen with him. And this is a way for him to come home and maybe do some things for the community and bring a Cleveland champion. They're certainly starving for it.
Yeah, you hit it right on the head. You have an opportunity to go somewhere and win a lot of ball games and do some special things. What he and the other guys did in Miami, that was pretty special. Now for him to go back home and hopefully return the favor, it's a smart decision. Really good.
You know, I think everybody completely overreacted when he left Cleveland, and I still think people are maybe overreacting a little bit that he's coming back to Cleveland. Yeah. I mean, he wasn't the villain I think a lot of people made him out to be when he left, and he's not this hero for coming back. He's making a decision of what he feels is best for him, and that's what it comes down to. Now, I think it does come down to him being liked a little bit, but I do think it comes down to I want to live my life in Cleveland. That's where I want to play. I don't think that makes the guy a hero. I just think that makes him doing what he wants to do.
You guys remember in your lifetime a bigger free agent deal, though? Peyton Manning going to Denver, Gretzky going out to L.A. Has there been a bigger free agent signing that you can remember?
I don't think so, just because he's clearly the best player in the world. And any team that he goes to is instantly going to be a challenger to win the whole thing, and especially in the Eastern Conference. Yeah. You put him on any team in the East, that team right there is probably the odds-on pick to play Oklahoma City or the Spurs in the finals.
And I just brought up Peyton Manning. He's getting to the tail end of his career, you know, and just where LeBron has, I think, quite a few more years of good basketball.
Steve said, is Cleveland better than Miami right now?
There's no question, even with Luol Deng and Chris Bosh getting the max money deals. But I think beyond that for LeBron is, it's amazing to me, the LeBron signing, how it changes how everything else in the NBA goes in free agency and trades. That changes everything for everybody else. Chris Bosh, okay, I'm not going here, I'm not going there. Okay, where's Dwayne Wade going now? I mean, everybody's waiting to see what he does before they make their decision on where they're going. I found that interesting.
Yeah, nobody's had more power than him ever. But if you're Kevin Love now sitting in Minnesota, are you doing anything you can to get out of Minnesota and join LeBron in Cleveland?
Well, he came out and shocked us all by saying that he'd be intrigued with the possibility. Yeah. But really, we had no, it didn't see that one coming at all. I think it's going to be interesting to see what they do, because will they move Wiggins to get a Kevin Love? I think they should. I don't think LeBron James wants to sit around for 3 or 4 years while you build a bunch of rookies around him. I think he wants to win now. So I think Cleveland's downplaying that a little bit, but I wouldn't be surprised to see them include Wiggins in a deal to Minnesota.
Kevin Love and LeBron James together would be pretty special.
It would be.
So, you know, if I were him, I'd like to.
If I'm Flip Saunders, I play the card of just up in the ante, and I wait until the last possible second, whether it's Golden State, whether it's Cleveland, whatever. You got to do what you got to do to put him wherever. Yeah. But Cleveland's clearly where I think he'd sign a long-term contract.
And Cleveland's coach has come out and said they don't want to give up Wiggins in a trade for Love. So Cleveland's going to be pretty good no matter what they do. Even right now with Varejao and Deion Waiters and with Wiggins there, they're pretty good right now, even if they don't get Love. But it would be fun to see him go there.
Well, if they get him, I think their big three in Cleveland is better than the big three was in Miami with Kyrie Irving at the point. Because you got a true point guard, which they never had in Miami, and you got Love and James, two guys that can play really well off each other. I think that would be a tough team to beat.
I completely agree.
All right. Enough NBA. We're in Fargo. We're going to talk some Bison football when we come back. Can they win the national championship again? We'll find out.
Benchwarmers on Midco Sports Network is presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Welcome back to Buffalo Wild Wings in Fargo, North Dakota, home of the North Dakota State University Bison. Talking Bison football now in the opener at Iowa State, just over 6 weeks away, guys. And it's life after Craig Bohl. It's life after Brock Jensen now. Three national championships in a row. What are the prospects for four, Tyler?
We've got a lot of young kids that are ready to make their mark on Bison football. A lot of kids who have just been waiting in the wings to get out there and prove that they belong. And there's, you know, Carson Wentz is going to be the quarterback, and he's got a lot of talent. Smart kid. And I remember him as a freshman. He was, you know, he could pick apart a defense, understand a defense, analyze everything right now. He's a smart kid. Defensively, there is a lot of veteran guys coming back. You know, I think 9 starters out of the 11 last year will be back. So it's just, you know, getting everyone on the same page come, you know, August 30th. We have 3.5-4 weeks in August to get everyone ready. And through that time, you know, we'll work hard and everyone will be committed. We'll prepare and then we'll go compete August 30th.
All right. Brian, you're going to be doing the games on TV again this year. Just your initial thought on what's coming up.
Well, you know, I think the thing, we've been so spoiled here, and not only because they've just won all the games, but we've looked at this team and not only their frontline guys, but their backups. They've had so much depth at every position that even when a guy went down, another guy would step up, you really wouldn't lose anything. I don't think that's going to be the case this year. I just don't think they have the depth and the numbers at all the positions they've had in the past. So I think injuries are going to be really important through the first part of the year, keeping certain guys healthy. And, you know, that could be a challenge because they got a grind of a schedule. They got 12 games. They opened with a Big 12 opponent. And then they got Montana coming in on September 20th. So I'm excited to see what this group can do. I think I like it to maybe the 2010 or 2011 team that were a playoff team, and they got better as the season went along, and I think this team has a chance to do the same thing.
Steve, biggest question in your mind?
Well, I think Tyler nailed it when he talked about the attitude of the guys, and you put a big challenge in front of a competitor, and you're going to see what those competitors have, and you look at what NDSU has done, some of the best football they've played, going to Kansas State, going to Minnesota. Craig Bohl takes a new job during the playoff run, they respond and get that job done as well. There's a lot of kids that are ready to step in and get it done. Are they a one-loss team or an undefeated team again? Maybe not, but could they be a two-loss team, maybe a three-loss team? Definitely so.
All right. Everybody kind of is downplaying it a little bit, which makes me laugh because I still think NDSU is going to be the best team in the Missouri Valley. Do they at least win the Missouri Valley this year?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think so.
Absolutely. I wouldn't put it past them. These guys have been through it before. Maybe they've got a little different roles now, coaching-wise. But the players have seen what it takes, and they want to prove a point. They're talented. Their recruiting is just as strong every year. They definitely could win the Missouri Valley again. Yeah.
I think the league's depth has gotten better, and I think we've seen a lot of teams get a lot better even this last year. I think the Illinois States, I think the Youngstown States, I think the Northern Iowas are all still good.
State's going to be pretty good, but so you get to the Missouri Valley, and then you even talk about national championship at this point. Playoffs last year weren't even close. And some of the big contenders in the FCS have moved up to the FBS. It just seems like it's still wide open for the Bison to do it again.
I think it's wide open for a lot of teams. And I think it's too tough to tell now.
Yeah.
With I mean, you can't just say with the talent they lost and the guys that are injured that won't be back this year to say, boom, we're going to not skip a beat. You could have said that last year going, I'd be like, dude, sign the paperwork. I'll buy my plane ticket. They're going to win it. Right. I think there's too many new pieces to say they're the odds-on favorite. But I do think they're very talented, and they have as good a chance as anybody to win a national title. I will say that.
All right. We get to find out soon. That's going to be the fun part about it. And when we come back, we'll talk about a couple of guys that played for the Bison last year, what their prospects are in the National Football League now down in Miami with Brock Jensen and Billy Turner.
Benchwarmers on Midco Sports Network is presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Welcome back to Buffalo Wild Wings in Fargo. Back to Bison football now, and a couple of guys that were a monster part of the three national championships in a row, Brock Jensen and Billy Turner, both end up down with the Miami Dolphins now, trying to make that team. Talk about Brock Jensen first, a free agent contract. Sounds like they got two guys locked in ahead of him, Ryan Tannehill and Matt Moore at quarterback, but he's in some competition for that number three spot.
Yeah, Pat Devlin is the guy that he's battling. You hear little rumblings coming out of Dolphins camp. They really like Jensen, his leadership, and the way he just kind of gets people to revolve around him. I think if he gets a chance, he can absolutely make it. I'm convinced that he's got everything between the ears that you want. He's got a strong enough arm. He's a big enough kid to take a few hits. And you bring Billy Turner in at guard, you can run that quarterback draw stuff you ran at NDSU, so right back at home.
Tyler, just physically skilled as Jensen is, does he have the skills to play in the NFL?
Yeah, I think so. You know, he's a bigger kid. What's he, 6'3", 220 pounds. He's got that moxie, you know, a guy you want to be around, be in the huddle with. He's very confident. I think he's got the tools physically to make the roster. I really do.
There was a guy named Steve Walker that had the same kind of moxie. The problem with Steve is he was 5'11", 175 pounds, where Brock has a 6'3", 220, as Steve said. So I think the physical tools, I think they look at him, probably think some things are a little bit raw, but he played in a pro-style offense, so I think he has the terminology and understanding of the concepts, and I think that probably puts him ahead of a lot of other rookies.
And Billy Turner, he's going to be playing some football now.
Yeah.
He's going to fit in very well. He's going to do well for that team.
Yeah, Turner, like, third-round draft pick. Yeah. I mean, he's the guy that they really wanted there to begin with. Their other first-round pick was also an offensive tackle. Sounds like Turner might be in some competition to play at the guard spot in Miami instead of the tackle spot.
He'll be an interior lineman. He'll fit in very well, I believe.
All right. Marcus Williams was another guy, part of that three in a row for the Bison. He is in Houston now as a cornerback, and that's, I don't know how many cornerbacks you keep on an NFL roster, but does he have a shot to make it?
I think so. Athletically and just understanding the game. It's very smart. You know, knowing where you're at on the field, down and distance, you know, what the offense is going to do, understanding your opponent, what you've got in front of you, the wide receiver you're going up against, he's very smart. And a lot of people didn't know that about him. And he made a ton of plays for NDSU. I see him, he's not on the outside looking in. He'll be a fall camp battle guy to make it in. But I think, if he doesn't make it with the Houston Texans, he'll be on a practice squad somewhere. He'll be in the NFL this year.
Sounds like he's in a pretty good situation in Houston, though, where they've got a couple guys locked in, but there's some spots, opportunities there for him.
Yeah, I think there's opportunities for him to win a spot. Again, coming as an undrafted free agent, there's a lot of guys that come in as undrafted free agents and open eyes and make teams. So I think Marcus, I think you look at maybe some of his numbers in the combine and think, well, he only ran a 4.56, blah, blah, blah. But I think when you're looking at a guy that is so instinctive, I think that's a great word to describe him, is he sees things happen before they develop. And I think in the NFL, you need guys like that.
To have three guys make it out of that class or out of that team from last year would be a big deal, probably since when you were there.
And Brian Shepherd, too.
I agree.
Brian Shepherd going to the Washington Redskins, a lot of people don't know Brian Shepherd. He played a lot of special teams. And his speed, flat out, he's one of the fastest guys. So he'll be one of the fastest guys for the Redskins. He'll have a good chance to make that football team.
Great special teamer, great tackler. And those are two things that it's nice to have in a slot guy if you can have.
He'll do some corner, too.
Yeah.
And today's NFL is a quarterback-driven league. That means everybody needs to have five, six good DBs on their roster. You got 30 teams, 32. times six. I mean, do the math. There's opportunities for guys that can play.
All right. We'll see soon if those guys can make the NFL rosters. And when we come back to Fargo, we'll go into the crowd for our Winging It question.
Benchwarmers on Midco Sports Network is presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Welcome back to Bench Warmers. Time for our Winging It segment, a question from the crowd. And for that, let's go to Katie Lingle.
All right, thanks, Tom. I'm joined now by Vanessa. She's got a great question for our panel. Vanessa?
Will Bridgewater start for the Minnesota Vikings as quarterback?
All right, guys, what do you think?
All right, the question, who should be the starting quarterback for the Minnesota Vikings? The choices are all really good here. Teddy Bridgewater, Christian Ponder, or Matt Cassel? Go.
Here's my two cents on Teddy Bridgewater. I think he threw a little bit erratic in his pro day. Now, he had a very good career at Louisville. I think he'll get huge opportunity all fall camp, preseason games to be an integral part of the offense. At the end of the day, it's going to be Matt Cassel. You know, I think for the first half of the season at least, and then groom along. You know, their OTAs, their practices got shortened this year. So he's going to need a little bit more time to understand the ins and the outs of that offense. I think it's going to be Matt Cassel for the first half of the season.
I would say Matt Cassel, but I would not be shocked or surprised if Teddy Bridgewater was behind center. The reason I say that is because with Norv Turner, a guy that is the new offensive coordinator, is bringing in new concepts for everybody, not just the rookies, and I think he's going to give everybody a clean slate. And I think if Bridgewater does enough to win the job, he has a history of bringing along young quarterbacks. It's not out of the realm of possibility. Now, do I think the odds-on favorite is Matt Cassel? Absolutely. But if the guy goes in there and proves he can get the job done when the bullet's flying, what the heck? Why not let it go, man? See what happens.
Vote of confidence right there, Steve.
Well, I will be shocked if he gets the call on opening day. And he's certainly a guy that has a lot of upside. I actually think he's going to be a really good pro. But I think you've got a guy in Cassel that's shown you can win games with him. Is he great? No, but he is slightly above average. And he's got some receivers around him. He showed last year that he's got the goods to get the job done. I think Bridgewater is going to be very good, but I think for a coach to come in and put a rookie in there right away, as Tyler said, with a little bit of shortened work here in the spring, I think that's an awful lot to ask.
All right. After those convincing arguments, are you sticking with Cassel?
I am. Right. I think he'll do well. He did well that year with the Patriots. Or it was the Chiefs. I think he's a good vet.
It won't
really
be Christian
do.
Ponder. Right. You said they got three good choices. They maybe got two.
Yeah. The other two guys get hurt in fall camp.
There right. You go. Right.
All right. There seems to be an affinity here between Fargo and pro sports in Minnesota. Would you guys agree with that? That there's kind of a kinship there between the two cities, and a lot of people from Fargo are big Minnesota fans. I'm talking about the Major League All-Star Game. Why is it a big deal that it's in Minneapolis this year?
I just think with the ties, it's a short distance away. I think people growing up here will be Twins fans, Vikings fans, Timberwolves, Wild, etc. I just think that there's a close relationship, and there's no other big market except the Bison are the show in North Dakota, I believe. So I think that they kind of relate to those big markets in Minneapolis.
Yeah, well, Brian and I are from the Twin Cities area. A lot of people have moved up here for work or family reasons, and you have those ties to the teams you grew up cheering for.
We don't get a lot. We haven't had a lot of big events in Minneapolis either recently. When you think about it, before we used to have the Final Fours, the Super Bowls. When's the last time we had anything like that? Anything like a big sporting event in Minneapolis? It's been a couple of decades. So I think that in itself is exciting for the city.
All right, one more touch on Bison football when we come back. Our poll question, kind of a trivia question this week on who holds the single game rushing record at North Dakota State. That's when we come back.
Benchwarmers on Midco Sports Network is presented by Buffalo Wild Wings.
Welcome back. Our Benchwarmers poll question this week, more of a trivia question really, but who holds the North Dakota State record for rushing yards in a single game? 29% for Lamar Gordon and Sam Ojeri. Gordon has the season and career records, but the correct answer is C, Tyler Roehl. 36% of the people here in the building got that right, but 263 yards against Minnesota in 2007. What do you remember from that game?
Feels like just yesterday, but that's almost 7 years ago now. A great opportunity for NDSU to get on the map. You know, we had a good opportunity to go you know, the year before we lost by a blocked field goal to U of M. And then in 2007 we went and beat Central Michigan, kind of got things rolling. They were the MAC champs that year. Beat them 41-14. And then we had a lot of confidence going into that game against Minnesota, and you know, and just grinded it out, ran the ball quite a few times, and you know, had a heck of a day. You know, one I'll always remember.
Although I'm not so sure. I think a few of those yards actually came on a swing pass. I'm not so sure those were red.
Come on now.
Just a long handout. No, it was a blast, and it was the first time we were talking about earlier when you felt like kids from North Dakota can do this at any level.
I agree. I remember being there too, and it's funny that building is now, you know, completely demolished, and they don't play football there anymore. But you know, I remember thinking that too. Is like, man, they looked so even on the field, even the first game. You know, I think when they scheduled that first game, I know Gene Taylor was really kind of concerned, and Craig Bull even was about scheduling that game. Like, I don't know if we're there yet. But then after that first game, that's when I think we all realized, okay, we can compete with anybody at this level from an NDSU standpoint. And I think that was really the time we all thought that, and that was really cool.
All right, Tyler Roehl is the correct answer, and he got it rolling with the Bison here in Fargo. Thanks to our panel this week here at Wild Wings in Fargo. Next week in Sioux Falls with Slade Larscheid, Mark Ovenden, and Holly Borchers. Thanks for watching Benchwarmers.